Hello, and welcome to part two of Evaluate's video series on evaluation, the secret sauce in your ATE proposal, a video series for individuals applying to the National Science Foundation's Advanced Technological Education Program. This video series accompanies the August 2019 webinar. Check out video one for more information about why evaluation is important to include in your proposal. My name is Lissa Wilson-Becho, and I work for Evaluate, located at Western Michigan University. Evaluate is the evaluation hub for the National Science Foundation's Advanced Technological Education Program, or ATE for short. Although Evaluate is funded by NSF to provide guidance on evaluation matters, we do not speak for NSF. This video introduces the essential elements of an ATE proposal evaluation plan and jumps into choosing and identifying an evaluator. So nearly all types of NSF proposals are limited to 15 pages. These little paged thumbnails are images from Evaluate's most recent funding proposal. As you can see here, we dedicated approximately 1 to 2 pages to our evaluation plan. We recommend the same for most proposals. So in this 1 to 2 page evaluation plan, you should identify who is going to evaluate your project, identify the evaluation questions, describe how you will collect data to address those evaluation questions, and explain how you'll make sense of those data through analysis and interpretation. Note how information from the evaluation will be communicated and how the project will use that information. And you'll also need to convey a timeline for the evaluation. So for Evaluate's proposal, we actually included this with our overall project timeline, as you can see here. So Evaluate created the evaluation plan checklist for ATE proposals to identify the components of a high-quality evaluation plan. Check it out to learn more about each of the sections we just mentioned. So let's take a deeper look into the evaluator section of an evaluation plan. NSF likes to see a specific evaluator who has committed to working on the project named in the proposal. If you're unable to identify your evaluator in your proposal, state why you cannot select an evaluator and your plan for finding an evaluator when the grant is funded. Then briefly describe the evaluator's qualifications and how those qualifications match with the evaluation plan for your project. For example, if you have a highly quantitative evaluation plan, the evaluator needs to show that they have experience in quantitative evaluation. Then, refer to the evaluator's bio sketch and letter of collaboration, which should be uploaded with the proposal as supplementary documents. The bio sketch should make the case that the evaluator is well matched to the project, not just that the evaluator has experience. Evaluators are professionals whose job it is to investigate a project's quality and impact based on evidence. There isn't any specific degree or certification that allows a person to work as an evaluator, so it's incumbent on the client to pick an evaluator that has experience that matches the needs of the evaluation plan and of the project team. So here are some qualifications to look for when selecting an evaluator for an ATE project. The evaluator should have experience evaluating STEM education projects. They should have strong research and evaluation skills. They should have strong communication skills and a service orientation. And they should have some understanding of NSF and the 2-year college contexts. The ATE program solicitation states that the funds to support an evaluator independent of the project must be requested. So what counts as independent? Well, so we have our project. Someone working on the project, like a PI, co-PI, project manager, or even a participating faculty member, would not be considered independent. This project sits within a department, and the same goes for someone outside of the project who works in the same department. There's just not enough independence here. The department sits in a college. According to the ATE program solicitation, the evaluator may be employed by a project's home institution as long as they work in a separate unit, like a different academic department or an institutional research office. And outside of the college is the rest of the world. An evaluator out here has the highest level of independence. Unless that person has another role on the project, then that evaluator would not be qualified. So now that we know who counts as independent, how do we locate qualified independent evaluators? Well, as evaluators ourselves, we like to ask the data. So to get a better sense of how ATE projects are obtaining their evaluators, we asked ATE PIs how they identify their current ATE external evaluator on the 2019 annual ATE survey. So here is what 236 current ATEPIs said. 66% said they either asked a colleague for a recommendation or selected someone they had worked with before. 15% said they used their grants office to select an evaluator. 9% issued a request for quotes or proposals. 9% described other, so these answers varied and included someone else made the selection or met the evaluator at a meeting or a conference. Less than 1% used an evaluator directory. The big takeaway here is that over 165 current ATEPIs used a colleague or their grants office to identify their external evaluator. So keep this in mind when you're looking. So here are a few resources on the topics to check out. So first, Evaluate has created a guide to finding and selecting an evaluator for ATE proposals. It walks you through the process of identifying an evaluator for a project, and it answers common questions about this topic. Second is the evaluator's biographical sketch template. As I mentioned earlier, the proposal should include the evaluator's bio sketch in NSF format. So we've created a template we suggest evaluators use to highlight their skills and experience. In the next video, we'll be talking about writing evaluation questions.